Hello students, this is Professor Sagar Birje and welcome you all for the online class of analog and digital electronics. So in continuation with my previous video on solving the examples using Patrick's method, so in today's class we will be taking another example where we will be applying the Quinn-McCloskey as well as the Patrick method for finding out the minimal solution for a given Boolean function. So let us start with the example, students. So here already I have written the problem. So just quickly we'll review the application of Quinn-McCloskey method first, and later once we have prepared the prime implicant chart and identified all the prime implicants, then we'll apply the Patrick method in getting the minimal solution. So the problem definition is, students, to find the minimize the following function by Patrick's methods and also find the minimal sum. Fine. Now the given function consists of four variables A, B, C, D with the mean terms 4, 5, 7, 12, 49, 15. Okay. So let us apply the Quinn-McCloskey method first. So what we are going to do? We are going to arrange all the mean terms and represent their binary representation. So for the mean term 4, 5, 7, 12, 14, 15, we have the binary representation. For those 4, we have 0, 1, 0, 0, 5, 0, 1, 0, 1. Similarly, 7 has 111, 0, 111, 12 has 11, 00, 14, 111, 0, and for 15, it is all 41. So, after representing the binary terms, what is the second step? Categorize those mean terms according to the occurrences of 1 in their binary representation. So we have 4 in one group, 5 and 12 in one group, 7 and 14 in one group, and 15 in one group. So 4, it as it has only single ones occurring, so I have categorized 4 here separately. So 5 and 12, they have two ones occurring, so I have categorized 5 and 12. Then 7 and 14, so they have three ones occurring, and 15, it is categorized separately as it has four ones occurring. Okay. So after completing your step 2, step 3 is to pair the mean terms if they differ by 1 bit position. Okay, and pair those mean terms and write them in the next column. So the mean term pair and the binary representation pair. So when I compare the mean term 4 with the next higher order category mean term 5, you can find it differs in the 3rd bit position. So I have written, I can categorize the mean term 4 comma 5, it has 0, 1, 0 underscore. So wherever they are differing, we know that we have to put an underscore there and put a tick mark whichever the mean terms are pairing. So similarly, we repeat the steps for 4, 5, we have completed, 4, 12 is the next pairing, then 5, 7 is the next pairing, 12, 14 is the next pairing. 7, 15 is the next pairing and 14, 15 is the next pairing. And similarly, we have put the underscore in those positions wherever the bit position is changing. So this step 3 is completed. Now once again, try to repeat step 3 and find out if there is possibility of elimination of further literal. So here you can find there is no possibility of further literal, because when you compare 4, 5 with the next higher order category mean terms 5, 7 or 12, 14, you can find there is no underscore at the same position. So, and similarly, when you compare 4, 12 with this other two higher order category mean terms, you can find there is no underscore in the similar position. So, possibility of grouping with first two thing is not possible. Similarly, 5, 7 and 12, 14, when I try to compare with 7, 15 and 14, 15, you can find the underscore is present in the third position, whereas in the third position there is no underscore. So further we cannot eliminate any literal. So directly we list out all the prime implicants. So you have total 6 prime implicants that we have identified. Now our next aim will be to find out the essential prime implicant. So for that we have the prime implicant chart. We list out all the prime implicants, and then in the vertical column we have all the prime implicants, in the horizontal column we have all the mean terms which are a part of my function. So in the column, in the respective column, I put a check mark, cross mark for which the mean prime implicants are present. So here 4, 5, I have marked 4, 5. Similarly 4, 12, 4 and 12, 5, 7, 5 and the prime. So here you can see the prime implicant chart, where in the vertical column you find all the prime implicants listed, and in the horizontal column you have all the mean terms which are a part of my Boolean function. So in front of those mean terms, what we are going to do, we are going to put a check mark in the respective columns wherever these mean terms are a part of my prime implicant. So here you can find in the first prime implicant 4 and 5 I have put a cross mark in the respective columns. Similarly, prime implicant 2 4 12 4 and 12 5 7 5 and 7, in the fourth prime implicant 12 and 14, fifth prime implicant 7 and 15, and in sixth prime implicant 14 and 15. So in this way we have prepared the prime implicant chart. Now check out whether we can find out the essential prime implicant. So as the rule says, there should be only single cross present in the respective column of that mean term, then that mean term can be considered as a prime implicant. So you can find there is no single cross in any of the column present. So for this, there is a cross present here, there is a X here, but there is a X present in the next column. So here also there is a X present here, there is a X present here, there is a X. So column wise, if you go, you cannot find there is a single X present in either of the column. So it is very difficult to find out the essential prime implicant. So in order to do that, from here onwards we apply the Patrick methods for finding out the minimal solution. So we are going to apply the Patrick method to find out the minimal solution. So let us see how do we apply this Patrick method in finding out the minimal. So let us now apply the Patrick method for simplifying the given function to find the minimal solution. So already we have prepared the prime implicant chart and we know the prime implicants. Now here we are going to represent a label to each prime implicant. So I have given a labeling to all the prime implicants that we have come across. So total we have 6 prime implicants. I have given the name P1, P2, P3, P4, P5 and P6. Okay. Now, what is the next step that we need to do? So we need to write a function P. So we need to write a function P which includes all the mean terms. So whatever function P we are going to write, it should include all the mean terms. All the mean terms in the sense what? It should include 4, 5, 7, 12, 14 and 15. So we are going to write a function P. For that, what we are going to do is, we are going to include all the mean terms that we are going to select for the prime implicant. So to include the mean term, the first mean term. So to include the first mean term 4. You can see the mean term 4. When I want to include this mean term 4, so 4 is present in which all prime implicants here? Go with the cross mark in those respective columns. So if you see, 4 is present in this prime implicant which I have labeled it as P1, as well as 4 is present in this prime implicant P2. So I will include P1 and P2. So it will be P1 plus P2. Okay. So my first mean term is included. Fine. Next, what I do is my next prime implicant. So I will write all the prime implicants 4, 5, then 7, then 12, then 14 and then 15. Okay. So I have written all the prime implicants, mean terms. Now 4 is over. Now go with 5. In 5 you see in this column where all there is a cross mark. 5 is in, is a part of P1, that is the first prime implicant, and 5 is a part of the third prime implicant, P3. So P1 plus P3. So I write here P1 plus P3. Fine. Similarly, we have 7. Similarly, we have the mean term 7. Now 7, you can see, is a part of the prime implicant P3 and is in P5. Sorry, I by mistake, here P5. So
the prime implicants that I am going to add is P3 and P5. So, P3 and P5. P3 plus P5. Fine. P3 plus P5, 12 is a part of P2 and P4. P2 plus P4. 14, you can see the cross marks in that respective column of 14, mean term 14. So it is a part of P4 and P6. P4 plus P6. Hope whatever I am doing, you are understanding. This is a function P. I am going to have a function P which should include all the mean terms. For that, I am going to check out which all prime implicants this mean term is occurring. So column wise, if you look into the prime implicant chart, easily you can find out where that prime implicant, mean term is occurring in which prime implicant. So 14 is over, 15 consists mein hai, P5 and P6. P5 plus P6. So now, once we have this, what we are going to do? We are going to write the function P. Once we have done with this, write the function P. What we said, the function P should have all the prime implicants. So 4 is getting added with P1 plus P2. 5 is getting added with P1 plus P3. 7 is getting added with P3 plus P5. 12 is getting added with P2 plus P4. 14 is getting added with P4 plus P6. And 15 is getting added with P5 plus P6. Fine. Now, what is that we are going to do? We are going to apply the distributive law. After this, apply the distributive law. Kya kehta hai distributive law? X plus Y into X plus Z is equal to X plus Y Z. Okay? So, find out the term which is common. X, okay, P1, first column is first product term se jayenge, P1 plus P2, P1 plus P3. So, yahan pe kya hai? P1 common hai. So, P2 we can term it as Y and P3 we can term it as Z. Okay, so what we'll do? P1 plus P2 into P1 plus P3 is equal to P1 plus P2 P3. Getting? Because this I have termed it as Y and this I have termed as Z. P1 is the common term. Now, go with the term. I take it as Y and P6, I take it as Z. So, P3, P6. Fine. So, this is over. Now, the remaining two terms are P2 plus P4, P4 plus P6. P2 plus P4 and P4 plus P6. Ismein kaun sa term common hai? P4 is the term which is common. I treat it as X, whereas P2 I treat it as Y and P6 I treat it as Z. Okay. So after having this, we'll write the sum. P is equal to P1 plus P2 P3 into P5 plus P3 P6 into What is that we are going to write? P4 plus P2 P6. Getting? So this is what we got after applying the distributive law. Fine. So now what you are going to do? Multiply the first term with the second term and remove the redundant term by applying the formula x plus xy is equal to x. Okay. So what we are going to do? Multiply the term. Here I will write. Multiply first the two terms and remove the redundant term. Remove the redundant term by applying the absorption law x plus xy is equal to x. Okay, x plus xy is equal to x. This is what we are going to apply. Now let us take these two terms. Which are these two terms? Okay, I will write it here. Let me take this two term, P1 plus P2 P3 into P5 plus P3 P6. Let us multiply this. Now what I am going to do, students, I am going to multiply P1 with P5. So P1 with P5. So P1 P5, okay, plus P1 with P3 P6. P1 P3 P6. Okay. Plus I am going to multiply what? P2 and P3 with P5. So P2 P3 P5 plus P2 P3 with P3 P6. As P3 P3 is multiplied, it will be P3 only. P3 into P3 is P3. So P2 P3 P6. Don't write P3 P3 two times. So P2 P3 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 6. So this is over. So what I got? I got the term P1 P5 plus P1 P3 P6 P2 P3 P5 plus P2 P3 P6. This is what I got it. Fine. Now what is that I am going to do after getting this term? Okay. So here P1 P5 plus P1 P3 P6 plus P2 P3 P5 plus P2 P3 P6. I am going to multiply with the remaining term. Which are those remaining terms? Yahan pe. Which are those remaining terms? Here. P4 plus P2 plus P6 into P4 plus P2 and P6. Okay. So if we multiply, what is that we are going to get? We are going to get a big list. P1, P5 into P4. So P1, P5, P4 plus P1, P5, P2, P6 plus P1, P5, P2, P6 plus. Now you may multiply. P1, P5 is multiplied with these two terms. Now P1, P3, P6 is going to be multiplied with P4. P1, P3, P6 is multiplied with 2 and 6. So all the terms we are going to multiply with the terms which are present in the second bracket. So we have a list of terms coming out. So quickly I will write P1, P3, P6, P4 plus P1, P3, P6, P2 plus P2, P3, P5, P4 plus P2, P3, P5, P6 plus P2, P present here. Now what is that? Find out the term which is common redundant term we are going to remove it. So yahan pe take 2 3 and 6 try to find out 2 3 and 6 is common somewhere, you try to eliminate those terms from those respective terms which are present. Fine. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take p2 p3 and p6 this term. Okay, now find out in whichever term this p2 p3 p6 is present. So if you see next to this we have p2 p3 p6 and p4 here. So isko le lete hain plus what do we have p2 p3 p6 and p4. Okay, so what is this? When I say this, I take this x plus 2, 3, 6 as x and this as y. So this is x. So answer kya aega? X plus xy is equal to x. So answer will be what? P2, P3, P6. P2, P3, P6. Okay. So this term p236 I have taken it as x, so 236 is present in this term, so I treat it as x and p4 as y. So x plus xy is equal to x. So we have applied the absorption law. So this is first. Now second elimination. Okay, second elimination is where you can find 236. So p1 p3 p6 p2. So P1, P3, P6, P2. यहाँ पे देखिए. Okay. So find out that. So P2, P3, P6 plus which is the term I have taken now? P1, P3, P6, P2. Okay. So here you can find 236, 236. So this can be treated as x. So this gets eliminated. Okay, this is getting eliminated, this is getting eliminated. Okay, so again what we get is p2 p3 p6. So p2 p3 p6. Now find out there is any other term which is still having p2 p3 p6. Yes, we have another term present here. Term that we are going to take is P2, P3, P5, P6. So P2, P3, P5, P6. So here P2, P3, P6 is present. P5 we take it as the Y term. So what comes out is P2, P3, P6. So you can find this term got eliminated first, this term got eliminated next, this term got eliminated next. Can you find P2, P3, P6 again in some other thing? 2, 3 is there in this, but 6 is not there. 1, 5, 4, no. 1, 5, 2, 6 is present, but P3 is not there. So 3, 6 is there. P2 is not there. So further elimination of the terms is not possible. So we could eliminate 3 terms. Now let us sum those terms which are now available. So the terms which are available are P1, P5, P4, P1, P5, P2, P6, P1, P3, P6, P4, and there is one more term present here, P2, P3, P5, P4. So 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So there will be 5 terms in my final expression P. P is equal to P1, P5, P4 plus P1, P5, P2, P6 plus P1, P3, P6, P4 plus P2, P3, P5, P4 plus P2, P3 and P6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 terms are present in my function P. Okay. Now what we are going to do? We have this function 1, function 2, function 3, function 4 and function 5. So the next step is we are going to select those terms which are minimum, okay, which has minimum term. So the function which has minimum term will be a part of my final expression. So the what is that? The problem definition is find out the minimal sum. So minimal sum is what? The terms, minimum terms which are present in a given function. So yaha pe kitna hai? 1, 2, 3. This is one thing I can include. Here F2 mein, function 2 mein kya hai? 1, 5, 2, 6, 4 terms are there. No, I will not take. F3 mein bhi 4 terms hai. F4 mein bhi 4 terms hai. F5 mein 2 term hai. So I will include this. So my function F1 which includes P1 plus P5 plus P4, okay, which is P1 mein kya hai? A bar B C bar plus P5 B C D plus P4 mein kya hai? A B D bar, okay, and we have another function F5 equal to P2 plus P3 plus P6 is equal to P2 mein kya hai? B C bar D bar plus P3 mein kya hai? A bar B D bar plus P6 mein kya hai? A B C. So this is what we can consider. Now we can say or function F1 or function FY can be a part of my minimal function. So we are getting two different functions with minimum term. Okay. So as we have find out after applying the Patrick method, we have find out the minimal sum. So we have two minimal sums, F1 and F5, which contains P1, P5, P4, P3, P2, P3, P6, which are the minimal terms. So this is how students we can apply the Patrick methods for finding out the minimal sum. So hope you have understood the concept. If not, kindly go through the video once. So as I told you, 50% of this problem will be solved using Quinn-McCloskey method, and remaining 50% we are going to apply the Patrick method. So hope you have understood this concept. So for more explanation, you can go through the video of my previous example and also follow the video for finding out the process for applying the Patrick method. So thank you for watching this video. For any queries regarding Patrick method, feel free to contact me or text me. Thank you.